Greetings, owners of fine luxury cardboard rectangles. It's good to be back. I had a couple days absence, but I have returned, my friends. And I've returned with very interesting information about a brand new secret lair with a bunch of incredible and beautiful cards included. But the secret lair is also riling up the player base more than usual. There are a bunch of people who are genuinely angry about this secret lair, and for understandable reasons. So I figure what we'll do first is we'll do the good and then the bad. So we're gonna go ahead and dive into the cards first, and then I will explain to you exactly what it is that's different about this secret lair that is upsetting people, okay? So we're gonna start out by looking at Captain Sisse. So if you didn't know this secret lair drop here, this one is International Women's Day. So it's coming out at the beginning of next month. They really are having us jump through these hoops, you know what I mean? In terms of, here's another one, here's another one, here's another one, here's another one. Don't expect that pace to let up, my friends, okay? And I'll explain to you part of the reason that I expect it to be just as intense going forwards as well. But let's take a look at Captain Sisse first, because there's a piece of information on this card that I will use to illustrate to you that we've got a number of secret lairs already lined up, ready to go, we haven't heard about. So Captain Sisse is one white, one green, and two for a 2/2 legendary creature, human soldier. Obviously, all these creatures are gonna be legendary. Search your library, tap, search your library for a legendary card, reveal that card and put it into your hand, then shuffle your library. All right, so, on the surface of it, first of all, it's pretty cool. The style that they've chosen here is an interesting one. It feels like a blend of the Friday Night Magic promos that they did for a while with the white lettering, right? Because normally on Magic cards, you don't have the white lettering. It's normally in black. So they took the white lettering from the concept of those promos, but they've added it to a full art-esque. It depends on what your definition of a full art is. You may consider this full art. You may consider it an extended border artwork because you can see that part of the artwork actually shows up behind the text box there. And speaking of the text box, actually, I really enjoy the way that with like these multicolor cards, the green and white, you can see the shift from one side from green to white. Now, admittedly, the white one is probably the least impressive of these kind of color gradient setups, because it does just kind of come through as almost just translucent. Like the green one has a heavy green tone to it. The white one feels more clear than white, but there's only so much you can do with that, right? You have to work with what you've got. So when we look at the artwork on this card, you can see Captain Sisse, she is on the Weatherlight, a very, very famous part of the legacy weapon, right? Actually, I've got, right now I'm currently reading the first novel, like Urza here, he's responsible for the creation of the Weatherlight and all the different family lines coming together. Captain Sisse is actually part of Urza's plans. She's a big figure in the novels, obviously not like Gerard level big, but she is a pivotal character in the novels. It's always cool to see a new variation, although admittedly, almost every Captain Sisse, they feel very similar with the whole, like, there's not a lot of variation. She's standing there with the sword or standing there at the, like, wheel of the ship. And I guess, in a way, it makes sense. I mean, she is a captain, having her on the ship that she represents. And, like, the Weatherlight was almost like an extension of Sisse herself as well. So there is that. But either way, I absolutely love the way that the Weatherlight itself looks behind her with the gigantic, iconic wings of the Weatherlight kind of sprouting up there behind her, almost looking like they give an extra martial aspect to the artwork as they almost feel like gigantic axes. That's the kind of vibe it gave me at first. But you've got Sisse standing there all defiant with a almost katana-like blade? I don't know. Her sword, what is that? I guess it's not technically a katana. Katanas don't curve up that much at the tip, but either way, it's got that kind of a vibe to it. But you can see She looks very fit in terms of, like, she'd be ready for combat. You know what I mean? She looks like she's taking care of herself. She's got that long braid there that's kind of whipping out and curling. It's like, this is one moment after she just kind of snapped into a defensive stance with her blade held up like that, ready to go. Like, you can tell her body is just whipped in that way from her stance and the way her hair has just flipped out in that little curved manner. Either way, I really, really like the artwork for this card. And Captain Sisse is just an awesome card. Like, honestly, dude. As a commander, this thing is nutty. In any kind of deck with a ton of legendaries, it's amazing, too, because she doesn't just specifically find you legendary creatures, right? She can find any legendary items. And that makes sense, because part of the Weatherlight's quest was to go and acquire all the different pieces to create the legacy weapon, right? It's actually a really awesome story, and we will be doing lore videos breaking all of that down, because I'm actually in possession of virtually every Magic novel now. Very nice. So I said that this card was going to give us a piece of information that was a clue as to more secret layers, and that's actually tucked down all the way in the bottom left corner, and that is the 051. This is number 51 of the secret layer drops. But here's the thing. The constellation drops that they just did, like, a couple of weeks ago, like that brand new secret layer constellation that was tied into worlds, those numbers, the numbers on those constellation cards, are actually considerably, considerably higher than the number that we're dealing here with Sisse, right? Like, it, sequentially, it's actually all messed up. If you take a look at the, planeswalkers, the gods, they're ranging up, like, in the numbers in the 80s and things like that. So there is actually a gap numerically between them. And number 80 coming out before number 51 doesn't make any sense from a chronological standpoint. So we have a scenario where there are actually a bunch of secret lair cards ready to go. It may turn out that those constellation artworks were for the secret lair drop they just did were actually meant for a different purpose, but then they repurposed them into secret lair drops. I'm not 100% sure about that, but originally the concept for Theros might have encompassed all of the gods, and they might have just been like, oh, we're gonna put these. They might have even considered putting the constellations into collector's packs at one point. But either way, there's something going on with the secret lair where they're not being released in the particular order that they were created. So, I mean, we don't know exactly what's going on. Maybe over time we'll be able to piece it out together or get some information from Wizards on that. But I thought it was interesting to note, and be prepared, there are more secret layers clearly already ready to go if those gods were numbered up in the 80s and we're dealing with the 50s here, right? Even if the gods started down in the 70s, there's probably a gap of at least 20 cards. So we're looking at probably 5 or 6 more secret layers that we don't know about that are already ready to go. So the next card we're going to look at is Marin of Clan Nel'Toth. Now, unsurprisingly, all of these cards, I mean, you could, this is the International Woman's Day secret lair, but you could actually also call this Commander Drop secret lair, Woman Lady version, because it's all just commanders that are going to be sought after, right? I mean, Sisse is a desirable one. She's gross. Marin here is actually also really solid too. So 1 black, 1 green, and 2 for a 3/4 human shaman. Whenever another creature you control dies, you get an experience counter. Experience counters were an interesting concept that they came up with for the one particular iteration of the Commander decks. So I don't remember what year it was. It was a Commander 2016, Commander 2017. One of the commanders, every commander that came in that particular, or each box, had an experience commander. And you'd get different rewards for experience. Experience counters are interesting because they're counters you get as a player. And there are very few counters that you get as a player in the first place. But things like the energy counters that you could expend, like, you would use those. Experience counters in the most situations are just something that you just build up over. And it's a cool concept because it's like you're building experience over time and gaining more power. So I like that. So what do the experience counters do? Well, at the beginning of your end step, choose target creature card in your graveyard. If that card's converted mana cost is less than or equal to the number of experience counters you have, return it to the battlefield. Otherwise, put it into your hand. Now, this ability makes perfect sense from a green-black perspective. The two colors that have the easiest time returning creatures from the graveyard either to play or to your hand are indeed black and green. Black is better at putting creatures straight back into play with the whole like zombified undead methods, and green is better at like the regrowth, renewal, returning things to your hands, not just creatures, but anything. Green has a, you can get pretty much anything back from your graveyard vibe to it. And black has a, we can bring back creatures that have been destroyed vibe from the graveyard, right? Now, in terms of the story behind Marin, honestly, I don't know of any. There's a period of time in Magic's history where we don't have much lore to accompany the creatures that we get, which is unfortunate, and not just creatures. I mean, planeswalkers as well. I'm sure a lot of you remember, we were actually just talking about this in a live stream today. Ren and Six was created in Modern Horizons, but we know nothing about Ren and Six. There's no information about them. It's, in one way, it's okay to not have information about characters because it allows you to kind of create your own story as to what they are. And that's partially what we had to deal with back in the day, like when Legends came out. All you had was a card with maybe a little bit of flavor text to tell you what it was until the book started coming along. So, yeah, I just realized, I think I tried to show you guys a book when I wasn't on screen. I literally took the time to pull out a novel and put it up in front of the camera when I'm not on camera. I'm good at this, guys, I swear. It's funny to realize I did that already in this video. Anyways, when we take a look at the artwork of Marin, first of all, I don't know if I mentioned this on Sis 8, but I enjoy this new commander framing that they do, where above the name of the card, they put this sort of, it looks almost like the top of an armoire, but it gives the card a particular type of flair that initially will just tell you straight out that it's legendary. And I like the addition of the little under flair that they created for this as well. So instead of just having the wavy, almost triangular points that come off the top of it, there's actually a little bit on the bottom, which really helps to frame the name of the card and make it stand out. So that's pretty sweet. Now you can see here in the artwork, you've got Marin. She's got her hand on the head of this gigantic beast. Looks like a dragon to me. And you can see energy flowing out of her hand into it, right? Like basically, it looks from this perspective. Now, I'd really need to see the blown up art to know for sure, but it looks like she is infusing this creature with some sort of green power flowing out of her into the beast. And you can see that green energy kind of flowing out of multiple locations, including what looks like an eye. So this looks like her using sort of like rejuvenation magic to bring a beast back to life. Imagine that. Imagine you're in a fight and there are these massive dragons flying all over the place. And as a team, you manage to take one of these dragons down and it's laying there and you're thinking like, we can do this, we can win. And then the shaman just comes out and lays her hand on the dragon's head and green energy starts coruscating out between her fingers. And all of a sudden the dragon's eyes flare back to life. And you're like, oh no. That is some really, really cool flavor, let's be real. And honestly, for 4 mana, what you get here, I mean, every time you lose a creature, you're boosting experience counters, and you getting to return creatures like this. I don't play Commander, but this feels like a really, really strong Commander to me. The next card we're going to talk about is Narset, Enlightened Master. All right? So this is 1 white, 1 red, 1 blue, and 3. This is expensive. For a 3/2 human monk. Now, she has first strike and hexproof. Whenever Narset, Enlightened Master attacks, exile the top 4 cards of your library. Until end of turn, you may cast non-creature cards exiled with Narset this turn without paying their mana costs. Now that is a powerful ability. Good God. Commander decks have crazy powerful cards in them. You know what I mean? Like, they have crazy strong cards in them. And the ability to just play multiples of them for free just feels kind of out of hand. It feels dirty crazy, you know, where you just look at it and go, wow, like she feels really swingy. And the fact that she's hexproof is going to make her really difficult to deal with. Now, in terms of the overall design of the card, like visually, it's interesting to note that unlike the previous two cards we saw with Sisse and Marin, they were two colors. So the top little legendary frame and the text box themselves would have that sort of one color leading into another, from green to white, from black to green, right? But Narset's three colors. So instead of trying to come up with a mishmash concept of the three colors, what they've done is they've just gone with this almost like a little bit kind of creamy yellow vibe with it. It is white, but it feels off-whitish. And I think that's a better choice than trying to meld those colors together. In terms of the artwork, I absolutely love this artwork. There's just, it all comes together in such a way. Like, I genuinely enjoy this. This is a piece of art I could see myself actually hanging up on the wall. It is so evocative in such a different way than Meryn is. Meryn gives you that battlefield sort of vibe. Narset Enlightened Master, this gives you the vibe of that monk up on the hilltops, like out in the mountains. You can see actually, the vista behind her is quite nice. She's up there in the mountains and it's really high, you can tell as well. But you see all this kind of mist flowing behind her as well, which gives her more of an unearthly vibe. And she's standing there in this cool monk position with like the one hand set in a particular gesture with her fingers, while the other hand is holding a staff. She's got this curve to her body, the way her hair is, her beautiful long hair is flowing out, and she's got like that little bit of like white hair at the front. She's, honestly, she's kind of giving me like, did you ever watch the old X-Men cartoons, like way back in the day? She's kind of giving me like a Rogue vibe with the color of her outfit and her hair and everything. But I love it. She's still like, there are literally flower petals that are all swirling around her. So there have to be these like trees that are surrounding her in the area, and the petals are all just kind of blowing. You know, like the cherry blossom trees and the petals kind of floating down. It just gives this particular energy to it that I absolutely love. Honestly, I don't know if this is my favorite artwork out of all of them, but it's right up there. I really, really, really enjoy this card so much, honestly. It's really well done. It looks like it was done by Livia Prima? It's hard to read the name there down at the bottom because it's tiny, but honestly, I absolutely love this. This is like, these cards, not Sisse, but Meryn and Narset would be auto-includes in my cube without a doubt. Without a doubt. But you can't, there are no tutors in my cube, so you can't use Sisse. Next up, we have, a very cool character from the stories. We've got Una, Queen of the Fae. Now, this is an interesting one. Her casting cost is 3 hybrid black, blue, and 3. So you can play her in a straight blue deck, you can play her in a straight black deck, you can play her in a combination, whatever. This obviously is another, these are all gross commander choices. So you're paying 6 for a 5/5 flying fairy wizard. Pay one blue or black and X, choose a color. Target opponent exiles the top X cards of their library. For each card of the chosen color exiled this way, create a 1/1 blue and black fairy rogue creature token with flying. Admittedly, I don't know how great this ability is in a commander environment, right? Like how many different colors are commander decks running in the first case? If you're playing, the more colors your opponent plays, the less powerful the ability becomes. On top of that, it's a mill effect, and mill effects against a gigantic 100 card deck, which most likely have ways to recur stuff from the graveyard or shuffle stuff back in, doesn't feel like that strong of a strategy. On the other hand, you can use it to self-mill yourself if you want. You can use it to generate creatures, so it does have that. It is a thick, fat 5/5 flyer. And, I mean, for me at least, Una represents one of the coolest storylines in Magic the Gathering. The Lorwyn storyline was very interesting. Lorwyn was a plane that was locked into, you know how like places like Alaska have crazy long nights and days and stuff like that, have like really messed up day and night cycles or whatever? Well, it's a similar kind of concept where Lorwyn would be locked into a world of like summertime and happiness and friendliness, like everybody's having a good time. And even like the things that would be vicious normally, like evil goblins and stuff like that, are more just like pesky troublemakers. Instead of a goblin burning down your village and like laying waste to everybody, they would come up and steal the pies off of your windowsill or steal your goat or something. You know what I mean? Like, it had a fun fairy tale vibe to it. Somewhat kind of like Throne of Eldraine, but on its own, with all these characters that lived in perpetual summer for hundreds and hundreds of years. But then they would switch to living in, like, the Dark Realm. It's like every day and ever night, essentially, right? Like, really, like, every day summer environment, ever night cold, like, not summer environment. And the contrast between the two was amazing. And it affected all the races on Lorwyn very drastically, where you would have, like, you would have all the worst aspects of their culture just kind of blown out of proportion and turned into something far more vile. So in the summertime version, you would have your Kithkin, and they were like happy little, we're the hobbits, and all our brains are all connected with the Thought Weft, and it makes us all able to, like, have a really nice, strong sense of family and community. But when you flip into the shadow version, they still have this shared thoughts. But now instead, that shared thoughts is turned into like a xenophobic sort of paranoia of outsiders, a distrust of anyone who is other. And that, I thought, was very interesting. You had a very massive contrast between the two versions of the world. And what was actually making this happen was Una. Una the Unchanging. Una would not... Una and her fairies were the only beings, with the exception of some giants. Some giants would be able to remember the world of light or the world of darkness, but they were taken to be the ravings of madmen, you know? So it's basically just Una's at the heart of this. She's the catalyst for this change. It's how she is sustaining herself, essentially. She's got her own plans, and they were changing the entire face of Lorwyn. So Una is a very pivotal character in the story, which is pretty cool. And Una looks amazing here. I like this. This is a very interesting depiction of a fairy queen, right? She's essentially made up of all of these blossoms and flowers. Her entire body is comprised of those sort of things, except obviously you can see, like, her arms coming up, but all of her clothing is basically flora. And she's got this serene, calm kind of beauty. She's the greatest blossom of all. I love the artwork here with all of the branches and brambles kind of encroaching around her. This is some really striking artwork on a very, very cool card. And the last one we have to talk about is a card I feel like I never actually saw before. Because when I looked at Saskia the Unyielding, I'm like, what is this from? This has to be from a commander deck, right? Like, there's no other thing that I could think this is from. Now, this one's interesting. Saskia actually costs 4 mana, but it's 4 different colors. So in one way, she's cheap, and in another way, she's super expensive. 1 black, 1 red, 1 green, and 1 white for a 3/4 human soldier with vigilance and haste. As Saskia the Unyielding enters the battlefield, choose a player. Whenever a creature you control deals combat damage to a player, it deals that much damage to the chosen player. I love this ability. Honestly, you don't even need to be playing in multiplayer for this. In multiplayer, it's an amazing way to be like, all right, I'm going to go and attack this guy, but you're going to get beat down. Versus in a two-player game, you're just like, oh, guess what? All my creatures are basically going to do double damage to you. Like, that's nutty, man. She's like she operates like a creature furnace of wrath, right? Now, admittedly, when you look at the artwork, you can see her, like, leading all these other soldiers into battle. It makes sense. She is built like a tank, right? Like a brick house. She has got, like, the broad shoulders. She's got big, beefy arms. Like, this is a giantess, essentially. And she's obviously born amongst a warlike people, right? And they're clearly just going to follow whoever's strongest. So she has proven her might. There's something about the size of her, the hair, the big old battle axe. It makes it feel like she should actually be more like a human berserker. You know what I mean? Like, she doesn't feel like a soldier. I don't get the soldier vibe when I look at her. But, I mean, that's a minor quibble. Overall, 4 mana for a Vigilance Haste. Like, this is the kind of card that can turn the entire game on, like, just like that. You know, turn it on a dime. you can easily flip things around and take over a game with a card like this. So from that perspective, a very potent commander. Now, I do have to admit, out of all of the artwork, I find this one to be the least engaging. I just don't care that much about it. You know what I mean? It's obviously well done. The artist that painted it is talented. But for me, when I look at it, it's just, I just go, meh. You could put this on any number of, like, you could put this on a raise the alarm card or something like that. Create 2/1/1 soldier tokens. And I'd be like, eh, okay. Like, this artwork does not excite me. The card itself is awesome, though. Instant include in the cube for sure. But the artwork just loses it for me. Now, I did say that I would cover why people are unhappy with this. Why this secret layer is making people more unhappy than usual. I want to look at both sides of the issue. Now, one of the things that's contributing to this is just product fatigue, where the Wizards is constantly cranking things out. And like I said, based on the collector numbers and everything, we've got more. You know, where did I put that book? Now, so I don't feel silly. When I mentioned the book earlier, for those of you who stuck around, here's the book I was talking about, derp. Anyhow, the secret layers, there's going to be, this is just going to be a thing. In fact, as far as I recall, Wizards at one point registered a website that says subscribe to Drop Series. So I wouldn't be surprised if this turns into a subscription series where they're like, get on board so you don't feel like you're missing out. Now, this secret layer is the most expensive secret layer they've made. This is $50 and there's only 5 cards in there. So one of the complaints people have is that it's $50. Another complaint people have is that it's for charity. Now, we're going to examine this charity thing from both sides because I think both groups of people, the people who are fine with it and happy with it, and the people who are angry about it, both have valid points, okay? So this product is $50. 25 of those dollars are going to be donated to Girl Guide charities. That's the plan, right? So there are people who are upset because it's essentially been made more expensive so Wizards can give money to charity. But the thing is they're making you give your money to charity. They didn't say, we're going to make this a $40 set and give $25 to charity. They said, we're making this a $50 set and giving $25 to charity. And Wizards gets to write the amount that's given off, right? Like, when companies do this, when they say, oh, we're going to give whatever to charity, they get to do that as a tax write-off. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong with tax write-offs for companies to give to charity. It's great. It incentivizes like corporations to end up handing money over to charities, which is always a great thing. Helping charity, yes, that's awesome. But at the same time, they're forcing you to pay extra to do it. And there's no opt-in or opt-out where it's like, I just want the cards. It's like, no, you have to donate to this charity. But Wizards gets to essentially almost make money off of the donation half too, because it will reduce their taxes. So they're taking your money and they get to go, we're giving to charity, when they're not actually giving to charity. It's your money, and Wizards gets to claim that back on the taxes. So from that perspective, I understand why people are angry about that, right? And there's also anger over the fact that they're moving up the price floor of Secret Lairs, because up until now, Secret Lairs were $30 or $40. Now they've made a Secret Lair that's $50. Not everybody is going to think of that in terms of the charity. They're just going to think, oh, now Secret Lairs can be $50. So they've raised the price to $50, and they've raised the number of these Secret Lairs you can get to 15. So Wizards is increasing the amount of Secret Lairs you can purchase and also increasing the price. And I wouldn't be surprised to see future Secret Lairs that cost more money without offering more value, right? And aren't giving to charity. So I can understand people being upset about that. Now, I can also understand it from the people who are more than happy to give to charity. They're happy to buy it and go, oh, cool, I'm buying this product and it gives to charity some of the money? Cool, I'm on board. I understand both camps. If you want to buy it and give it to charity, fantastic. If you want to buy it but you're unhappy about them giving to charity because of the way that it's done and it's essentially just taking extra money from you, then I also understand that. So I don't think that anybody is wrong in this case. There's sometimes when people are worked up and it's like, no, you're off base here. And there's other times where it's like, okay, I get it, right? So we're in the new realm now. We have left the old world. We're in the new world now where Wizards is selling us singles directly. The camera! camera shut off because I was talking for so long, I guess. So, let me know your thoughts in the comments below, my friends. What do you think about the whole idea of the charity aspect of it? Does it bother you? What do you think about the cards in particular? And what do you think about Secret Lairs? Are you getting burnt out? Are you excited for more? Personally, while I think they release them a lot, I still want all the Secret Lair cards. So thanks for coming by. Glad to have you all here. Big shout out to my patrons and channel members. I'm gonna get on up out of here. So for now, that means I'm history, baby.